go ahead and call this meeting to order. This is the joint conceptual meeting of the Board of Mayor and Aldermen and the Franklin Municipal Planning Commission for Thursday, June the 23rd, 2022. So we'll start with a roll call vote. Commissioner Allen is not here yet. Commissioner Franks?
Here.
Commissioner Harrison?
Here.
Commissioner Lindsay's here. Commissioner McLemore?
Here.
And I think Commissioner Mann will be here shortly. Commissioner Orr?
Here.
And Commissioner Peterson and Commissioner Williamson, I don't see yet. Alderman Berger, Alderman, watch the meeting on Franklin TV or the City of Franklin website. Watch the live stream through the City of Franklin Facebook and YouTube accounts, or attend in person here in the boardroom. The public may also watch the meeting on the TV in the lobby. Our first item tonight, item number one, is discussion of a development plan proposing approximately 348 multifamily units, 14,000 square feet of office, 3,700 square feet of bank, 6,000 square feet of retail, and 130 hotel keys on 34.2 acres located at 211 Cool Springs Boulevard, otherwise known as the Optima PUD. And we're going to use our new format for this meeting. We're going to start off with staff presentation, and then we'll go with an applicant presentation, which we expect to be short and concise. And then we'll kind of poll the Board of Mayor and Aldermen and the Planning Commissioners. We're not going to roll call forcing a comment out of each of you. If you've got something to say, we'll recognize you and let you do that. So, Amy, if you'll proceed.
Yes, thank you. And so to clarify, I'm going to give a very succinct presentation to allow as much time for the applicant as possible. And one thing I did want to mention, that this cycle, the way the joint conceptual works against the review cycle of applications, is that these applicants have not yet received their initial submittal comments. They've received our pre-application comments, but they haven't received initial submittal comments. So if there's, we've done our best to get information to them ahead of this meeting, but just so you're aware, there's still ample time for them to make changes. So in terms of the Optima project, this plan is for mixed-use development on the NHC site along Cool Springs Boulevard. The plan generally meets Envision Franklin and the regional commerce design concept. The plan is not asking for any modifications of standards and generally meets the zoning ordinance as currently shown. So barring any applicant-driven changes, the plan you see now is most likely the one you will see at Planning Commission in BOMA. A TIA is required, and staff is currently reviewing that for suggested traffic improvements. The architecture will be required to meet the zoning ordinance when it goes to site plan. What's provided in the concept drawings are concepts only and will probably change slightly in regards to the requirements of the building type. Sewer location has not yet been finalized. Staff would not support what the plans show on the plans today, but has provided a routing that we would support and is to be incorporated at resubmittal. So there'll be opportunities for the applicant to work with our staff to finalize that and correct what's needed. The site has floodplain on it, but only the proposed walking trail encroaches into the existing floodplain. So I can answer any questions at the end, but we can turn it over to the applicant now.
Okay. Applicant?
Good evening. My name's Scotty Greg. I'm a landscape architect with Reagan Smith. I'm here on behalf of Florinoy Development Group, and NHC is their joint venture partner on this. They're also the owner of the property. As you're probably well aware where NAC is, we're at the sort of the intersection of two main arterial roads, Cool Springs Boulevard and West McEwen. It's a signalized intersection. You'll see sort of on the screen we're highlighted there in pink. So we're part of the regional commerce design concept. I'll speak a little bit of that more later about how we're following sort of the principles of that. But just in general, this is an area that supports sort of a high-intensity activity centers with, connectivity, walkability, sort of as a main focus. We're currently zoned RC6, Regional Commerce 6, and we're really very consistent with the zoning that's currently in place in terms of uses, the way that it looks. There's only a few triggers that sort of encourage us to come before you and request a PD zoning, and I'll go over those triggers after the presentation. So here's the overall site plan. As mentioned earlier, the overall site is 34 acres. The existing NHC campus is roughly 16 acres. The proposed development there on the right, which is rendered, is about 18 acres. So it gives you a good idea of the scale and the massing of the site. Again, at the main intersection of two main arterial roads. So this is perhaps one of the most focal points of a project you're gonna get a lot of activity. When we look at development and a layout, there's several things that come into effect. Envision Franklin, all the different requirements of the zoning code, the stormwater regulations, fire, connectivity. And in addition to that is existing conditions. So I think probably the most fun part about this is trying to figure out how to thread the needle and make a special place, make something that works with all of those, that sort of complies with everything. A little more about that. This proposed layout, it's mixed use development. The way that the buildings work is there's sort of two frontages, right? There's one on Cool Springs Boulevard, and then also internally there's sort of our main spine road. So on this specific site, as I mentioned, some of the existing conditions are constraints. We essentially know we're going to have a spine down the middle of the site, which splits it in two. So we have to be very strategic about how we orient the buildings, where the building massings can go, how the parking works, make sure that we place the parkings behind and in the back, make it secondary in nature, place walkability and architectural standards sort of at the forefront, the open spaces of the site. So all those are very, very critical. And as I mentioned, with slopes and other stormwater items, we're sort of left with a very, prescriptive types of elements we have to incorporate into the design. As I mentioned, we do have our minimum 5% open space, but I don't think that quite does it justice. If you look beyond the requirement, there's a lot of open space here. Perhaps one of the most and special parts of the entire project is the existing greenway at the rear of the site. Something interesting about that existing greenway is not currently in an easement. The proposed project would be dedicating that greenway for public access. Probably more importantly, we're proposing on the left, sort of highlighted in the gray line, a connector of the greenway or multi-use path to the public right-of-way. So again, this very completely consistent with the master parks plan. I think something, again, special about this is one opportunity you can blend natural with sort of this urban dense core and how that works. Additionally, we have some primitive trails that will cut through sort of the tree canopy and sort of the slopes there along the back. In terms of the uses, I have some slides, but wanted to talk a little bit about the uses. Again, 130 key hotel, roughly 28,000 square foot of commercial space. And of that space are some live-work units along the bottom, sort of D, E, and F. So the component of this is how do we keep this commercial, flavor not competing with Cool Springs Galleria or all the stuff right next to us, but provide a sustainable amount of commercial space that will work well for this neighborhood component, the existing NHC facility, and then activate the streetscape. So the way we've done that is we have the more intense commercial uses right on Cool Springs where you would expect to see them. And then internally on the spine, we're providing all commercial use on the main ground floor level. So no residential units there. Again, that's sort of a key component to pulling people into the site, giving some opportunity for spaces for tenants to start their own businesses. In regards to the rezone, I know part of the new process is to talk a little bit about, justification. Well, why are we doing this if RC6 is, really nice, it has all this stuff? And I mentioned there's just a handful of triggers that do that. A couple of those, one, we need to implement Envision Franklin, specifically, you know, tight setbacks. Envision Franklin talks about sort of this grid connecting the dots, good connectivity, having sustainable uses. So sort of all those key components are a part of it. Also, you know, we have very unique site constraints, as I mentioned, between topography, our central drive. The site is very narrow in width, so it really dictates where and how you can build when you must have parking behind and to the side. We have two primary frontages, again, that we have to sort of respect in one respect. Also, the RC6 allows up to 40% of your site to be of residential use. As this site sits as an existing campus, we would be at 55%. So I would call at a site like this probably a little over that minimum. So that's a component of that. And then again, some of the side and internal setbacks. So when you have a development like this where we're really trying to incorporate mixed uses into one, being able to do that internally and meet your side setbacks and control the setbacks, this is how we do it. So that would be our request, is to come in with a PD to get this. Lastly, as I mentioned, we're not requesting any modification of standards. So I think the intent is to be very, very compliant with RC6, but just make a couple of exceptions for those reasons. I'll just sort of click through these very quickly here. Here's the ground floor of the commercial space. It shows you how it goes internally into the site, sort of a key component to pull some energy and some walkability into that. There's the multifamily use on the ground floor in the back, but above the commercial space. We talked a little bit about connectivity, and I know I'm working the shot clock with some Q&A, so I'm going to sort of fast forward here. We are proposing both some parkland and some open space. The light green areas are the parkland areas. The main one is the greenway to the left and the up, which is public. The other ones would be private. We're requesting some offsets with that, going through the process right now to understand those elements. Won't get into this in detail, but with any project like this, we've submitted a study. In short, I just wanted to highlight probably the most critical pieces, other than we'll be making some improvements. We're the fourth leg of this intersection. So anytime you add that fourth leg, by default, you're going to modify and change if it was one unit or whatever, right? So we're looking at that. But the important part is with NHC, they currently have a full access going into their site. Working with the city, and I think the city's goal is to try and minimize, I say curb cuts, but access through the boulevard. So what this development will do is provides internal connection from the existing NHC facility to the signalized intersection. By doing so, we'll provide a right-in, right-out only, so it controls those turning movements, how they work. So really just a safety measure that is a huge win for, again, the road users, and I would say NHC and everybody else. Architecturally, again, I Envision Franklin talks a lot about a lot of things, but it mentions having, you know, good architecture all the way around. I think what I'll note on this is we're complying with the zoning code. So as Amy mentioned, there might be some changes, but thankfully the zoning code here in Franklin is very prescriptive and provides a high level of quality. I'm happy to say on this one, you'll see on sort of the sides, on the rear or the front, it all has that same view, that same visibility. So very key component. Here on the sort of bottom, the top picture, but on the bottom, you'll see more of this commercial style space. Again, trying to react with some of the styles of the architecture and how that works. I'm going to click through these two here. On this last slide, I'm sort of just going to hit a few of the items while you're looking at the image of some of the guiding principles of Envision Franklin. So there are eight of them. We're hitting seven of them. I feel pretty confident. And the one we're not hitting is due to, I think it's a historic preservation. So unless we uncovered something that I'm not aware of, we don't qualify for that. But manage growth is number one. You know, this is a very responsible, purposeful growth project. It's a dynamic of mixed uses. You know, the site supported by existing city infrastructure of Cool Springs on the commercial. We're proposing a compact land pattern with a focus on connectivity, not just vehicular, but pedestrian, from all the sidewalks, the greenways connecting people to sort of these commercial uses that we have in our community. Number two is economic vitality, you know, attracting new businesses. As I mentioned, sort of this live work, as you get back in the side, it really supports small businesses. It promotes these sort of incubator spaces, lets people start these businesses at a place they can live, literally work, go down. It could be something as a tailor, it could be a small office, and it gives folks to grow that business and ideally move into a larger space as they evolve. And number three is vibrant neighborhoods. This is definitely a pedestrian-friendly neighborhood. Sidewalks, trails, number one, right? We put parking and vehicular sort of to the back. You know, it's a redevelopment on a vacant lot. Envision Franklin talks a lot about filling up. When you have this urban fabric and you have a void in it, sort of completing the fabric to give you that fill, sort of massing as we go down the streetscapes. Number five, natural beauty. As I mentioned, this is probably one of the most fun sites where we literally have one of the best natural resources literally in our backyard on the site, where the residents of this facility, the users of the facility, the existing NHC facility, and the entire community will benefit from being able to walk down the sidewalk, jump on the greenway, and as our city grows and the developments grow along here, to connect per the master plan. Exceptional design, I've sort of hit on some of these, but again, high quality architecture, buildings oriented to the street, double streets, parking, you know, in the back, connected communities, number seven, again, sort of connecting the dots between all of this existing commercial, some new commercial, you know, existing residential, and then new residential. How do we do it in a way that's sustainable, that will be healthy and that will survive? Lastly, number eight is, you know, context responsive infill. I really feel this is perhaps super sensitive to Cool Springs, the area it's in. It's sensitive to the large mass of buildings we have with the offices next to us, assisted living, NHC next on our other side, our two arterial roads, sort of, you know, where you have development. NHC is very excited about this. It's, as I mentioned, gives them a place to have, I guess what they would call sort of an age in place. Either people can move into here, and then if they decide to go to the next chapter, they can move into the next facility, or families can be here. So they're really excited about that component. They've also mentioned they're super excited about having some walkable places where their residents can go safely. So that's probably the second component of that. But that said, I want to save some time for some questions. So by all means.
Okay. Thank you. So does anyone have any questions or comments on this? Yes, sir, Alderman Brown.
A lot to like, obviously the trails and the intergenerational, and I think tying back into NHC. I mean, I think there's a lot of good. I will say, though, this area, you know, between this, Haven, Legends, that's over 700 housing units right in this one spot, and on top of NHC already, in an area with McEwen growing pretty significantly. And while Cool Springs does have better infrastructure than a lot of other places, it is becoming less and less so. I mean, going through Cool Springs on a weekend is, most people will try to avoid it at this point. It is not enjoyable. I can't imagine what all of this density is going to do to that area there at Cool Springs and McHatcher. That would be my initial concern here. Not necessarily just this plan, but the totality of what we're doing in a very small area right there. And what that's going to do to that whole Cool Springs, McHatcher area right there.
Okay. Other comments? Mayor.
Sure. Love the trails. I kind of missed what you said about transitioning. You're talking about transitioning from here to NHC. Is that your thought?
Yeah, NHC.
Because this has no assisted living or independent. It's just apartments.
Correct. It is. So the existing facility is part of the overall zoning request. It would become a PD, but the new development doesn't have assisted living in it. That's correct.
My question, with this much density, why haven't you incorporated some transit into that and made some plans to connect to transit in other areas of the community, particularly all that? I'm choking on this. Particularly with all that density in that area.
Sure. Yeah, I think, you know, for us, transit's a great thing, right? If it's done by vehicle or by greenway or by whatever approach you take it, I think, you know, if there's a stop nearby or how that works, I think that's something that, you know, is a benefit to any development.
No, I'm urging you to do it.
Sure.
Not to talk about it.
Yeah.
Do it.
Yeah. No, I appreciate that. I think that's a very valuable comment. So, absolutely.
Other comments? Yes, Commissioner.
Work units. You said they'll be a part of this. And like how many or what are you, what are you anticipating?
Sure.
As far as people living there and having retail or whatever.
So there, I believe there are 16 units. It's roughly 16 to 18,000 square feet. It's based on the ground level that you're not living in. It's the commercial part of a live work. So not to be confused with residential units. You know, ideally, it's leased to folks that are living in there. But by all means, if it's, you know, market driven and they need to fill a space, it's commercial space.
But it's separate from the living. There's not commercial on the bottom and living space above it. All connected.
Yeah. That's correct. I don't think you're asking physically. Can you walk down into the?
Yeah, I think that's typically what we think about a live work unit. Yeah.
Yeah, this one's sort of set up just because we were a little we didn't want to come across like somebody's going to live in the bottom part of the unit. That's
right. Okay.
I think a challenge maybe. So,
a couple of points relative to the area along the creek. You're bumping up against the edge of the floodway buffer. Does the walking trail back there? Does that already exist? Along
yes.
the back of NHC and this property?
Yes, the back side is existing today.
Does it connect to the golf course? Is there a crossing?
It crosses over. It crosses over, and then I believe it goes to the development just to the northeast. There's a condo development there that it connects to, and then it, from what my understanding, it's going to continue due west with some of the improvements that are coming along.
So, and you talked about dedicated space along this creek. Neither the land behind this parcel or the land behind NHC where the trail is, that's not been dedicated yet?
Yeah, currently there's no easement in place. So this development proposes to put that in an easement. I think the intent is it's...
On this property as well as the NHC property?
Correct, yes.
Create the easement? Okay.
And the new multi-trail that we're proposing. So all... Let's call it those three legs, or you know, will be
right.
put into an easement.
And that multi-trail, that trail down the west side, isn't there a stormwater facility down the side of NHC down that side?
There is an existing detention pond. So this, the way that the layout literally works is it's sort of falling along the berm of that top of that facility.
Okay, is it your expectation that there would be or plans that there would be parking for? Is there parking associated with the hotel itself? Is there a level of parking within the building, or does it rely on parking immediately behind? Or
good question. So the parking for the hotel is behind it. So you'll see, I should have mentioned this, there's a slip deck. They're called slip decks. So it's essentially a parking structure without the ramp. There's access at the top level and then one at the bottom level. It keeps it very flush, sort of at the pedestrian scale. It would appear as one story, but that garage will provide parking for the hotel use, in addition to the parking that's shown behind it.
And that's the deck across the street in the back from the hotel.
Yeah. It's that's probably more of an internal
so
drive.
You've got
yes.
a small lot associated on the same side as the hotel, and then you're relying on the slip deck behind across the street. Okay.
Yeah, there's sort of, you can see how the access works there in this visual that shows you can go sort of on the top part or work your way down with grade to access on the lower side.
Okay. That's all I have. Yes, Alderman Potts.
Thank you, sir. I was going to see if we could pull up slide number 20. This goes directly to where the chairman was speaking about the parking deck. I wanted to come back to something that Alderman Brown had said that I was also thinking. I'm looking at slide 20 here, and we can really see it's a well-designed plan, of course. It looks great, but it is high density right here, and it really kind of reminds me a little bit of some areas over off of Carruthers Boulevard. and I'm sorry I can't think of the cross street right there, but the way it's laid out, there's an Aveda salon and some restaurants over there, but at Meridian, that's it. Just the way the layout is. I guess my concern here, if we go to slide 21, and this really gives a good scope of what this would look like as far as density, but from my perspective, one of my bigger concerns is in this area, what we have not done a good job of, and this is no fault to yours, is we have not tiered this area down from a story perspective as we've done in other areas where it's gone from 12-story or R12 down to R2, if you will, to two-story. And in this particular area, it actually goes all the way up to Mac Hatcher at six-story. And so I've got concern as this butts up against when it tees in right there to Roper's Knob. And what this is going to look like is more six-story and four-story structures start popping into this area. And, you know, I'm really looking to conserve our rolling hills and the vistas that really attract so many people here. And so when I look at slide number 21, and then I also look at slide 22, and I'm seeing how that six-story hotel butts right up against the Cool Springs Boulevard right there. I've got concern about that and what that's really doing to that area, because right next door to NHC is soon to be another large six-story apartment complex. So I'm really wondering what this area is looking like in the future. Again, it's a well-designed plan, but that's my greatest concern.
Okay, thank you.
Any other comments?
Question.
Yes, Jimmy.
Would your owner, a developer, consider or have any plans for sale units in those apartments?
They're not looking at a for sale product with this development.
We have a real shortage, it appears that way. And some of the other apartment owners have agreed to do a mixture, a small percentage, but,
okay,
you know, flats or condos or something.
Okay. We'll obviously discuss all of this.
Interested in that.
Yeah, we appreciate the comments, because this is our chance to get some dialogue going. So
you're building in the back. What's on the longest side of it? What's that length? And continue looking at that. From some of your renderings, it looks like that facade's broken up with some setbacks, and then some, it looks like it's just one long straight line. It's kind of hard to tell which it is.
Yeah. So we
definitely don't want long-lined buildings that tower over everything. We'd like to see that facade broken up into sections.
Yeah, we've had some very preliminary conversations. Actually, one of our pre-app comments was specific to the architecture. Our architects has reached out to staff and got some direction on that, and it's my understanding they're working through some of those details for the resubmittal, but specific to even the ground floor, the vertical elements of where they transition in materials and how those look there.
Is that something you're going to implement when we see it again, is breaking up that facade? And
yeah, by all means, I'll recommend that. I'll encourage that.
And Michael, I can add to that. You know, the zoning ordinance, I believe for this building type, requires that after so many feet, the building has to change in a lot of different ways so that it feels like a series of buildings,
right,
and not just one long facade that slightly changes. So things like the window shapes and muttons, the height of the cornice, the color, a lot of things have to change. So I do think that your concerns should be addressed with the zoning ordinance, but it's a good comment. Thank you.
You took care of mine, because that's exactly what I was going to say. Just look like you just went and just threw this blob of the same thing out there. So,
okay,
thank you.
Okay. Chairman Lindsay, I had a follow-up question on something that you had said. When we were looking at the parking area, and I was looking at the hotel, the parking, is there parking under the hotel, or are you relying on that two-level parking area that is adjacent to the other building for the hotel?
Yeah, good question. So currently the vision is that the part of the slip deck would be for the hotel. That's how the parking's broken out. We're honestly too looking at sort of how you share parking for overall mixed of uses. you know, at different times, right? That's something that we've seen as to not overpark something. And I think that's a challenge is how do we, you know, per what is required, we're overparked, but we're, again, it's sort of that balance of saying we're going to share these type of uses, right? And how do we show that? What standards do we use to do that? But yes, that is not, so far it's not underground. That could change. I think that's a little bit of the challenge is, you know, during an entitlement process, we're hopeful to get something in place, and that really attracts sometimes the ultimate, you know, either the flag or the end user. And those site plan specifics, as I've seen on other ones I've done, come in, and it's not unheard of that we come back before and say, hey, now we have a real building, and we may go back before if something significantly changes. But I think
And that actually leads me to the next piece. Yeah. With as much density as you're seeing right here, do you think that the parking garages on either flank could go up a story?
I think that's a great question. The way that it works now, they wouldn't work well going up a story just because of it would block the visibility, the view on the backside. Part of the strategy, when you look at this overall site, and I'm going to have to go back to this slide here. So you have, NHC has an existing parking lot, right? So we have some surplus built into that. We have, again, sort of these shared uses. And I think the strategy is let's maximize the parking that we already have in place and that we're proposing, again, to not build more than we need, right? Don't go vertical just to go vertical, but in the day, it has to function, it has to work. And if it doesn't, you know, you don't get leases or anything else. So it has to work for the program.
And to that point, too, staff reviews that shared parking analysis and determines whether we would support it or not. So far, we do support it, but we're continuing to review it. Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions or comments?
I just want to emphasize again, maybe they should, you know, with this much density, they got assisted living and nursing home next door, that there ought to be some kind of transit center or transit stop in that area that they plan for rather than just saying everybody's going to walk, because everybody's not going to walk, and as much density is occurring there, there's going to have to be some give as far as getting people around.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Within the development.
Yes.
That can be used by NHC as well as
yes. Because some of the most common use of transit currently in Franklin is going to the doctor.
That's a good point. And even when the development off of down near Dwell, all the new development down there, when you go over there, there's no parking. When you do those calculations, I mean, it just doesn't equate to all the people that are going to be coming over there, because every time I go there, there's no parking in those areas. So, I mean, what the mayor said makes a lot of sense. There has to be some measure to be able to help people to be able to come to those places and to those businesses and have somewhere to park or some measure to be able to attend events and not be concerned about parking, because every time I go, there's no parking in that area. Are y'all familiar with the area that I'm talking about? Over by Perry's, all over in the new section.
Where that was done under a different design, different zoning ordinance, and I wonder if that was part of the problem with that one. We were dealing with sort of a very old PUD that was approved under different regulations. So, but we take your point, and we'll make sure that we have the appropriate amount of parking, but not excessive parking.
Yeah,
because we don't want just empty parking lots sitting there either.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else? All right, with that, we appreciate it. Thank you. Our next item tonight, item two, discussion of a development plan proposing a 5,200 square foot training center and two additional accessory structures with modifications of standards related to roof pitch and encroachment into transition zones on 186.22 acres located at 750 Riverview Drive, the Franklin Bridge Golf Course PUD. Staff?
Yes, thank you. So this development plan is for an existing golf course. Like Chair Lindsay said, they are adding a training facility, and golf courses were placed in planned districts so that when any additions to principal buildings were proposed, that development plan would be triggered to be revised and brought forth to the public. So that's exactly what's happening here. The proposed development plan generally meets the requirements of the zoning ordinance. They've reduced their number of modifications of standards. Now there is only one, and it is for the roof line of the building. Golf courses are unique. Our zoning ordinance doesn't quite have a building type for this type of use, so by default they're going to have to use commercial building type, which requires a parapet. The context of the golf course is that the clubhouse has a pitched roof. They would like to continue that architecture, so staff would, you know, on the surface support that idea, that concept. And then the applicant is also going to need to request a variance for the frontage requirements. This building, the training center where it's going, they are limited because it's an existing golf course. They're having to put it within the course itself. And how they want to use the training center to sort of hit out of it with golf balls, they had to put it in certain places where they can do that. That means that they're placing it where the existing parking lot is and would be in front of the building. That's not permitted with commercial building type, so they're having to request the variance to allow that building to be there. That will be a part of this plan, and it will be decided upon by BZA prior to it coming to Planning Commission. So if it's still on the plan that way, you'll know that BZA approved it based on the criteria of a variance. So that's all staff has on this one.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Gamm?
Hi, thank you. My name is Greg Gamble, and I'm the landscape architect working as consultant for Franklin Bridge Golf Course. Tonight, I'm here with Brooks West, the owner of Franklin Bridge Golf Course. He's been the owner for approximately 3.5 years, and I believe has probably made more improvements to the golf course in 3.5 years than its 35-year history. He'd like to talk a little bit tonight about his vision, and then I'll walk you through our plan for improvements on the course. Thank you.
Thank you, Greg. Louder than most. Thank you for letting me be here and for all of your time. It's obviously an exciting time to be in Franklin. It's an exciting time for me and my own life, two young kids. We're a small business. I've been in the golf business my entire life, so this is sort of like my life's work and passion, and certainly a local owner who works in and on the business. We've spent 3 years really, you know, achieving or pursuing our vision to bring, you know, our 18-hole public golf course to match the community that it's in. No disrespect to the previous ownership, but Franklin is obviously known for all the reasons that you all are here and what you all are protecting and stewarding. So my goal is to do the same thing. Hopefully we've shown that with our actions and how we've reinvested in the property the past 3.5 years. And you know, today is sort of an outline of the next phase of that. And really to match the community with a couple components that Greg will go through. One of the key components that isn't a structure that I think is germane to this application is the short course. So we obviously are a busy 18-hole public golf course, but the reason a lot of people don't play golf as much or as frequently is, you know, it takes a little too long, maybe costs too much, and maybe it's too hard. Short courses, shorter golf experiences can really overcome that, really attract beginners, juniors. The low course does a beautiful job of that. So that's a big part of this. It feeds into the turn shack. Obviously, the learning center is the same thing. Really investing in that next generation. We have a terrific young teaching professional that's done an amazing job with juniors. We have 25 juniors out there this week, actually, with a junior golf camp. And then the other component is an on-course restroom that Greg will talk about. Again, just trying to elevate the golf experience to match the community. No one enjoys Port-a-Johns, maybe at Bonnaroo, you accept it, but we're trying to give a great golf experience to really serve the community that way. We've been experiencing a tremendous amount of support, and I'm really excited about what Greg's going to go through with you. So thank you again.
Yeah. Thank you, Brooks. So this is the golf course. It was constructed around the time when Forest Crossing began development. The property is in a PUD. It's a PUD. It's a PD district zoning, based zoning. Envision Franklin identifies the property as single family policy, which allows for recreational uses. This is the kind of the master plan of the entire golf course, showing all 18 holes. And wanted to use this as reference, but you can see here on the northwest corner of the property, this is adjacent to hole number 7. Brooks is planning to add a restroom facility. This will require some fill to make sure that the facility is out of the floodplain, but we'll be compensating for that fill in other areas of the golf course on this same side of the river so that it's balanced. This has to go to FEMA. It requires a CLOMAR approval, and then after grading, requires a LOMAR to complete that process. The bathroom facility is about 300 square feet. The zoning ordinance prohibits bathroom facilities on golf courses from being constructed in the 100-year floodplain, so that's why we're needing to raise this up. If we locate it to the east or north or to the west, now we're in the flight zone of golf balls, so we found kind of a safe zone, but it does require a little bit of fill in order to raise this area up to provide for a restroom. This is an inspirational image of what the bathroom facility would look like. We want it to be residential in character, stone base, hardy siding, really a building that has architectural character that's timeless. This is the area that is the short course that Brooks mentioned. If you've played the course before, this used to be hole 18. If you've not played the course before, it's along the western boundary to the north of the course, north of the clubhouse. This is a walking only short course, so no golf carts in this area, but highly refined, highly landscaped area as well. The turn shack is located just to the south of the short course and just to the north of the driving range. It's located on hole number 1. This is where the starter signals to the golfers that they can go ahead and tee off. It's also where the golfers who've played the first 9 are returning, so they can stop here for the restroom as well. There will be a concessions area within the turn shack, but most importantly, this is also a storm shelter. So during heavy rain events, golfers have a place to go to find refuge. Brooks has been very sensitive to the fact that the neighbors, adjacent neighbors, have been appreciating the views of the course, and has a very innovative idea to construct the turn shack in such a way where it blends into the landscape of the golf course. He's proposing a grass roof. He's proposing that the turn shack be lowered in elevation slightly, still above the 100-year floodplain, but minimizing that that view or blockage of view from the adjacent neighbors. Also built with stone, he's implementing here a flat roof, again, so that the view along the horizon by the adjacent neighbors would be diminished. You can see here in the bottom right corner, also under roof, a small little building that is associated with that. That's where the starter box is. That's where they've got the radios back to the clubhouse. They know who's going to be next on the tee box. And then you can see the open air underneath this that allows for people to get underneath this building in the event of rain or lightning. Third is the training center. This building, approximately 5,200 square feet, will include a few hitting bays that will have technology associated with it. The can I point using this? I think so. This side of the building here, this very narrow side of the building, is where those hitting bays will be located. And the rest of the building would include some fitness, some health kind of training area. It'll have an indoor putting area. And so it's really meant for that golf training experience. As Amy mentioned, you can see here on the left corner here, in context with the clubhouse and the parking lot, the parking lot is between the public right-of-way and the building. And because that parking lot, even though it's existing, is between the road and our proposed building, we have to ask for a variance for that. The zoning ordinance says that all parking lots are to be located behind the building. And you can see here, if we located parking behind this building, they wouldn't have access to the driving range. And so it is a request that we're going to need to make to the Board of Zoning Appeals. These are some inspirational images, again, of what this might look like. We would like for this facility, the training facility, to have a gabled roof. All commercial mixed-use buildings are required to have flat roofs. And so we're asking for a modification of standards to grant a gabled roof for this commercial mixed-use building so that it's in keeping with the architectural character of the existing clubhouse and the facilities that are there. With that, Brooks and I are happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Okay. Any questions? Yes.
Excuse me. First of all, I really like what y'all done with the course so far. I do play it. It's in incredible condition. I think it's a really valuable asset. I like everything that you presented. I think that, you know, adding the bathroom, I think it's going to be more aesthetic for some of the neighbors. Let's face it. We know most people don't surge out for the bathroom. And I think it'll help the, you know, gender of golf because that's only available for, you know, one sex. So I really like the bathroom idea. My only concern with the location of it is the floodplain alterations. So help me better understand. I know you're going to go through FEMA, but I know that that whole course floods, you know, pretty significantly, and especially in that area where you're wanting to put it. So you said you're going to build that up, but where were you going to counteract building that up?
So there's a couple areas. I mean, one area is there's a large mound on the first hole that's it's sort of like 40 yards short and right of the green. So there's a massive mound there that would, honestly, I think that would satisfy it alone from a 1.5-to-1 ratio, okay. Just that one place. So that's the primary position, Nick.
Okay.
And, I mean, there are so many places out there to cut with that wouldn't affect playability and would be easy to use for that. So that's the part, Greg.
Yeah, it is a small building, so I'm not overly concerned, but want to make sure that's accounted for.
Yeah.
I think that we what I would look for the final approval.
I agree.
Yes, Alderman Potts.
Thank you, sir. First, I think it looks great. I really like on slide 9, the green roof. I know that you've been working with all the residents there, and this really helps to meet that need. A lot of people have expressed that and reached out to me on that. I wanted to see if we could go down, and Greg, maybe you could kind of speak to this. On slide 10, on the bottom right-hand corner, it's got that small box where the key map is. One of the resident had reached out and was asking about along that driving range, and this may actually be maybe putting or chipping on bottom left-hand corner, right where the mouse is right there, that driving area along the street. There was some concern about balls being hit that direction. Wanted to see what was going to be done to prevent that.
Can you be a little more specific?
That's
a putting green right there. That's our new putting green. There's no full shots hit there.
To the left of that, that right where the mouse is there.
That's the existing driving range that is not, that's the same driving range location that's
okay.
Been there forever.
Good.
So I'm not.
I guess maybe there was concern from residents thinking that people were going to be hitting longer balls that direction that might slice out towards the street.
As a result of the learning center?
Right.
Yeah, the learning center orientates directly out the driving range.
Okay.
Towards the river, toward like number one green.
Perfect.
So it's literally 180 degrees away from the house.
Okay. Good.
So the one next to the putting green is actually the teeing area?
No, sir. I don't know exactly what the reference is to the putting green. The putting green by the road.
There's the putting green right there.
Yes, sir.
And then that.
Where your
is that, where
this
you,
is the existing driving range right here.
That the teeing area there?
Yes, the existing tee area.
Okay. Yes, that's okay.
All right.
Yeah, I think that should clarify where the ball is.
The only portion of the building where people will be hitting golf balls will be from this edge out toward the existing driving range.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. And then, yes, it does. And that's a resident was just a little confused on that part of it. And then the other part was with the parking lot, and this is my ward, that's why I'm asking. Mm-hmm. So I get the emails and the calls, right? The parking lot, and you guys have, again, done so many improvements, but they wanted to also ask and see where we might be going as far as additional lighting, and then also as far as light pollution at night, if there would be, because we know it shuts down at dusk, but still, if you could just kind of maybe speak to that. And then along the street right there where River Bend is, and we're on that same slide, it was on 10, and Greg, there may be a better one, where the parking lot meets River Bend right there, if there was any space to put any vegetation, any bushes to kind of break up from the street to the parking lot? Like a screen, yeah.
I would need to understand better where exactly you're saying. And what are they trying to screen? The building?
No, just parking. break up the parking lot. That was all.
Yeah, but yes. I mean, that's obviously expense and more maintenance than grass. But I mean, I think that's a reason. I mean, that's like an in general request because of the parking mm-hmm. and facing the housing.
Correct.
That would have more bushes than grass for visual.
Okay. Correct.
Yep.
Just evergreens.
Yep. Yep.
And those were the only three that I had from the community.
Point taken. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Other questions, comments?
I need to do a full disclosure here that the Bayer's Cup golf tournament is going to be there this year, and we're excited about it. And I look forward to hitting my tee ball on number 4 and being about 100 yards out. So I hope that we'll be able to accommodate that. But I think I was curious to the timeline, Brooks.
So nothing would start until January. So we would start the short course in January, and then the turn check would start shortly thereafter. The construction time on the short course and turn check, we would be open August 1st, August 15th, depending on the weather, as far as grow-in, establishment of grass, getting it to playing condition. The bathroom would be a little longer because we have to deal with FEMA and all those amendments take months and months and months. So I would say 18 months to 24, probably realistic on that. So wouldn't start anything on that. And then the teaching building, one thing Greg didn't mention is it's not germane to the pub, but there's a lot of underground utilities where this teaching building would go, so it would be it's not an easy project to locate the teaching building there. So my priority is the getting the clock running, ticking on the bathrooms, because it's not quick dealing with FEMA, and rightfully so, and then starting the short course in January. So start to finish, January through August. But from a homeowner's view, I mean, only the people that are facing that hole would have any disruption. There's no activity around the clubhouse, around the range, or any of those areas that he was speaking to. So no activity this year. So that answer your question? Thank you.
Okay. Other questions, comments?
I got one. Greg, can you point, or you have a pointer that can show on that overall map where each one of these elements are?
Sure can. Up here in the northwest, by hole number 7 would be the new 300 square foot bathroom.
And it's in the floodplain? That one's in the floodplain?
The area today is in the floodplain, but we're going to need to elevate it slightly in order to bring it out of the floodplain. And then this is the short course right here. And then this would be the turn check directly adjacent to hole number 1. This is the existing driving facility, and the teaching facility would be directly adjacent to the driving range.
So your net is running parallel to number 1?
There is a net along the driving range that runs right here alongside this edge, correct?
I'm sure you could get 100 different concept plans, but when I visualize the golfers Sunday morning teeing off at the tee box on the not number 1, but on the driving range. It looked like to me you could do a lineal building or a parallel building to the tee box that would give more privacy from the street and from the neighbors.
and incorporate the hidden bay and a few other things more parallel to the tee box.
Oh, if we moved the teaching facility over to that side of the
and just
the course,
run a building all the way down.
There are more constraints on that side regarding the 100-year floodplain, and so it gets a little tricky. But we've explored a couple of different options. We like that option next to the clubhouse just because of the proximity to the club and the starters, and to the golf pros office.
Needs a training facility and lessons and all that. Can you show me the rest of them?
Rest of
the bathroom.
Well, there's not going to be another second bathroom right now. We have a significant amount of floodway that crosses across this area here in floodplain. So we're looking at some alternative options for, instead of a permanent bathroom, maybe something temporary that can be moved. But we do want to have something better than porta potties on the property. Just on this side of the course, we're very limited on what we can do from a permanent structure.
I sympathize you going for variances.
Yes.
And with all that land out there, it looked like to me you could avoid those variances and possible floodway or floodplain. But I do like it. It's fantastic. It's a great course. You guys have done a great job putting it together. I'm supportive of it. But, you know, I sympathize the long time it's going to take and the exercise you got to go through to do it. The course needs turn shack, and it needs a hidden bay, and it needs a bathroom on each front nine, back nine.
Right.
Greg, can you go back to that slide you were on just a moment ago? With the, was it the turn shack, wasn't it? Slide number 8. That one. Okay, so the green dotted line is the flood fringe overlay line.
That's the 100-year floodplain.
Yeah. So, and obviously the mass of, I mean, there's a lot of floodplain out there.
There
and
is.
So my only admonition is that you'll build that in accordance with the city's requirements for construction in floodplains or in close proximity to floodplains. That's a delineated flood line on a flood insurance rate map. It is not a flood protection line, such that if you're standing on one side of the line, you're doomed to drown, and if you step across the line, you're good forever. I would build those buildings out of structures that recognize floodproof materials, a lot of concrete block, stuff you don't see on the outside. I mean, you got a nice architectural treatment, but build them out of materials that's easy to fix after they flood, because that's probably 100 to 150 square miles of drainage basin above this point on the Harpeth River. It's a massive river, and a lot of rain over a localized area, it'll get you. One of these days, it'll get you. So just bear in mind the need to be able to build out of something that doesn't have to be, you know, totally disassembled in order to put it back together in the weeks after the flood.
And Chair, if I might also, for anyone who watches this tonight or comes back and watches this later on, please note that we're talking about them building something that no one is going to sleep in overnight, okay? No one's going to be living in it. We're talking about a restroom on a golf course. Right. Thank you. All right.
Thank you all very much.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Yeah, you got some crazy golfers out there.
The next item on our agenda tonight, item number 3, discussion of a development plan proposing 142,500 feet of continuum of care facility and 130 multifamily units with potential modification of standards requests related to building type requirements on 31.5 acres located at 553 and 557 Franklin Road. This is referred to as the 555 Franklin Road PUD. So, Amy?
Yes, thank you. So, to orient yourself, this property is located just south of Gateway Village and north of Clearview Church along Franklin Road. And like Chair Lindsay said, this is for continuum of care and multifamily, that independent living that we have seen begun to be incorporated into continuum of care, but as it's, you know, not age restricted, it's not state licensed beds, it falls under the category of multifamily in our zoning ordinance. The uses in the building heights proposed meet Envision Franklin for the neighborhood mixed-use design concept. The plan complies with the zoning ordinance in many ways, but there is one revision that will be needed and will most likely change the layout being proposed. The mix of uses proposed may only use the multifamily building type as an option. That is staff's analysis of the site today. And the multifamily building type is required to utilize the urban frontage type. Multifamily building, urban frontage. That combination means that the parking must be completely behind the building, not just the front facade. So in order to meet the zoning ordinance, the plan as proposed today will most likely not be the plan that you see at Planning Commission and BOMA. The applicant has proposed MOSs based on building type, but they were based on the commercial mixed-use building type that they wanted to utilize. Based on previous discussions, staff believes they still may request some MOSs from the multifamily building type, but we haven't seen those yet because, again, this is still that situation where the applicant hasn't received the initial comments from our review. They've only received pre-app comments, so we're waiting to see what they need to change their MOSs to. The site has a hillside overlay and hillside buffer on it, and staff's initial review is that development is staying out of those areas and steep slopes. Sewer is being resolved with water management, and prior to resubmittal, there will need to be a meeting scheduled with water management to finalize that layout. That's all I have.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Gamble?
Hi again, my name is Greg Gamble, and I'm the consulting landscape architect and land planner. My client is Ryan Companies, and tonight from Ryan Companies, Sean Hunt and Drew Roscos are here tonight to present the plan for the proposed building. Sean wanted to tell you a little bit about Ryan Companies. They are new to Franklin, and I just wanted to introduce himself. So, Sean.
Thank you for your time this evening. I came prepared with some notes and slides to help you better understand who we are and how we go about our business and the level of experience that we have in doing this sort of thing. But
Are you Sean or Ryan?
I'm sorry?
Are you Sean or Ryan?
I am Sean. I work with Ryan Companies, U.S. Incorporated.
Okay.
That's important.
All I needed was your name.
No, that's important to know because a question we get quite often in these parts is where are we going to be able to build our next subdivision? Well, we are not Ryan Homes. And so what I'd like to do, not tonight, but at your convenience, either individually or in groups, I'd love to sit with you and help you better understand who we are and why you can depend on us. But I want to turn this over pretty quickly to my colleague, Drew Roscos. But I do want to mention a couple of things. First of all, we are a company that is national, and we've done senior living communities throughout the country. In the packets that you have, there's information that gives you a pretty good overview of the scale at which we've undertaken these things, how we go about it. And there is a section about our operating partners, which is very important. So I would like an opportunity at some point to sit with you and help you better understand that. The second thing I wanted to mention is when this comes before you for formal consideration, both FMPC and BOMA, you'll see that it will come with a requirement. Amy alluded to this briefly, but it will come with a requirement that before we can occupy this new community, this senior community, we need to engineer, construct, and fully fund a significant piece of city public infrastructure. It's part of the sanitary sewer system. It's about a mile away from our site. And current estimates tell us that before we're done with it, we'll probably spend on the order of $2 million for that upgrade. So I just want to point that out because you will see that as a requirement later. Now, having said that, I'll tell you, as I was taught to do, as a good Southerner, born and raised here, that we are thrilled and honored to be taking on that upgrade of the public infrastructure. In all seriousness, we're pleased to do that. We've been working very closely with Mr. Stuckey's staff. We think we know what we're doing, we know what we're doing, and we have the resources to pull it off. But you will see that, and it may raise questions when you do. So at this time, I'd like to introduce my colleague from Ryan A&E, Drew Roscos, who is a senior architect with our architectural group in senior living.
Thank you, Sean. As Sean said, my name is Drew Roscos of Ryan A&E. Thank you for letting me speak tonight. I'm going to gloss over the first few pages of slides because they're the part that Sean wants to review with you at a different time. I am a senior project designer at Ryan Companies. I specialize in senior living. I have a degree in gerontology, which is the study of the aging process. So this knowledge provides guidance and expertise in this field. So these are the slides I'm glossing over. Sorry to go fast. Amy mentioned this, but to give context for folks, our site is here. We are just south of Gateway Village, north of Clearview Baptist Church along Franklin Road. We are roughly 100, our building is set back 156 feet from Franklin Road. For context, Gateway Village is set back 145 feet, and the Baptist Church is roughly 150 feet. So we are maintaining that existing street condition that exists from our neighbors. Our building is a three-story mixed-use two courtyard building. Our site frontage faces Franklin Road, and our site access is off of Franklin Road. We have a access points on the north property line and the south property line connecting to Gateway Village and to the existing parking lot of the church. Our loading area and trash are located in the rear of the building. And then, as Amy mentioned, we have our parking currently proposed on the side of the building and set back behind the building frontage. And that's the part that is in question. We are building into the hill of the site. So on the top left corner of our proposed development, we have that gray portion, which is the structured parking. So we're burying into the building a little bit. In the pink area is our amenity spaces, which give the identity and the vibrancy of the community. We have assisted living and memory care proposed on the ground floor. And sometimes it's hard to understand what identity means for a proposed development. So we included some images of a similar project that we completed just this past year. It's another senior living community. And the reason that we provided these slides is to show the cultural and wellness activities that are typically provided within the senior living community. These offer older adults the ability to continue with the lifestyle that they're used to, and also the option to take up new hobbies or activities in this transition of their life. This is a simple massing model of the site features. So it's intentionally vague on window and entry points. This is provided to show the scale of our building and Gateway Village. So we are 1 foot taller than the tallest building within Gateway Village, and we are the same height as the ridge line of Clearview Baptist Church. So again, staying within context of our neighbors. This is the view from Franklin Road. We are following a Colonial Revival style of architecture. We are changing the massing, one, to break up the scale of the building, but also to adhere to the City of Franklin zoning requirements. This is an introductory slide to show you the north side of the building. So we're on the north side looking south at our proposed development. The dark gray line or portion on the bottom right-hand corner is the existing road for Gateway Village. What we're showing, why we're showing you this, is to introduce that we are providing a landscape buffer between our property and Gateway Village. And so this is a section through that area. So our proposed building is on the left, Gateway is on the right. In the center, where that gray line is the property line. So to the right of it is the existing landscape buffer that already is there. And then to the left of the line is our proposed additional landscape buffer. Going back to the elevations, again, we're pursuing a Colonial Revival architectural style. Here we're showing the massing articulation of detailing on the facade to break up the scale of the building and provide those that level of ornamentation that is required in such a City of Franklin. I would talk about the modifications of standards, but I don't think that's pervy to today's conversation, given Amy's report. That is the conclusion of the presentation.
Okay, thank you. Anybody have any questions for the applicant?
Question. Was there any attempt to design this building with parking in the rear, or was the building already designed and you just decided to ask for modification of standards?
I'll answer your question, Commissioner Allen. We've been working with staff, I think now probably 4 or 5 months, working on different master plans, different designs. Mm-hmm. And there are some nuances in the ordinance that relate to commercial buildings, mm-hmm. that relate to multifamily buildings. Mm-hmm. Both of those trigger some modification of standards. So in a multifamily building type, all ground floor residential units have to have access out to a public sidewalk. Mm-hmm. And for an assisted living facility, that's a little bit of a problem because you need the controls for safety. Mm-hmm. So that would be a modification of standards with the multifamily building type. Okay. Under the mixed use building type, you don't have to have the ground floor units directly up to the sidewalk, but it does affect where the parking is located. So we've kind of been going back and forth. We're still willing to, and we are going to continue to work with staff on finding a solution where this fits. And it's just a design detail. I think we can work through it, but it may take us a little bit of time.
It's just that I would ask, if at all possible, that you guys work together and not make it where we have this long list of modifications, just because you can't ask for them, for that to be, you know, just where you just can't make it work.
Sure. Right. And so for one of the modifications for the mixed-use commercial building is that they have to have flat roofs, and we were going to ask mm-hmm. for a gabled roof instead. That was one of the modification yeah. standards. So we're right. working with Good. Amy and staff, and right. we're going to come up with something fantastic to bring.
Because understanding everything just can't be by the book, but just, yeah, thank you. Sure. I appreciate it.
Okay. Other comments, questions? Yes, Alderman Brown?
Just on the water lot, the repairs of the sewer line vastly needed in that area. The question is, as you come down through there, and this is my understanding, if I'm wrong, correct me, but as you come out of that area down into what is being built now there, the development right in front of Morningside there, that was supposed to get an upgraded sewer pipe at that point. Did not, yeah, the oak, whatever, that the new one being there, that was supposed to be an upgraded, upsized sewer pipe. My understanding is that didn't end up happening. And so I know there's already concern in that entire area from Jackson Lake through Morningside about the already bigger developments that are already happening there. and more flow coming down that way. So I guess thrilled that we're going to address it, but are we addressing it all the way through? I leave that as a question. I know Michelle's not in here, so it'd be nice to just, Jimmy's over here. Sorry, you're behind me. Everybody's behind me today. It'd just be good to understand sort of, is that the same line we're coming down through, and do we feel like we have the volume to be able to handle all that coming down through there?
Good question. So as any developments proposed through this corridor, we model all the sewer all the way down, and there is at some point going to be some needed infrastructure south of Mallory Station Road. This development didn't trigger that improvement necessarily, but it did trigger, we had some pipes north of that were actually set flat, things like that had happened, so there was very limited capacity. So these improvements, basically you look at it like a traffic impact, but a sewer flow impact, they triggered these improvements. At some point the full upgrade will be needed through the golf course, but those weren't triggered at this time.
So when this sewer line is accommodated through there, does it also pick up Gateway Village? Is it?
So there's essentially one trunk line that runs all the way to Gateway Village from the railroad tracks at the golf course, and it would Gateway Village does flow to that line.
Okay.
The one that's being upgraded.
Other questions, comments? Yes, Jimmy.
We have transit capability to be able to, your traffic study would indicate probably less traffic being continuing care, how you've got it described. Can you talk about the traffic or the possibility of the Franklin Transit having a circulation through there?
The traffic study did result in a very low impact, as they do with any of these that we develop. But we also provide a shuttle service to take residents anywhere they want to go. Fact of the matter is, there's just not a lot of cars generated from our residency, and the shuttle service does a pretty good job.
Yes, sir. And then as far as the off-site improvements and the expense there, is there fees? I mean, you'll have your schedule of fees, Greg. Have you got an idea of what this project will generate with Franklin fees and the sewer fees and things like that, in addition to the offsite? And you know, is that being borne by solely you, or do you have recovery rights, or have you researched any of that?
Well, if you're asking me what the total amount of impact fees, et cetera, this project will generate, we do know that. If you're asking about a recovery, say this $2 million that we're spending to improve this downstream sewer line, we've been told that there are, it's not called recovery, it's called recapture.
Recapture.
That there is the possibility of a future recapture. We haven't learned anything more than what I just said. We'd like to know more about that, but no, we're not able to finance the project based on that.
Yes, sir.
So
it's very nice, thank you.
But the impact fees are as prescribed by city ordinances, and we will pay property taxes. That answers your question.
Yeah, thank you.
Quick question.
Yes, Commissioner Harris.
You're talking about your residents could be mostly using the shuttle or possibly their own cars when they go out. What's the, how much staff, what's the quantity of staff you're going to have on hand that will be create trips for the day? Does that factor into your traffic study?
It has factored in. We project a total staffing level of about 100. Those are spread over three shifts per day. The largest shift is in the 7 a.m. to 3 p.m. shift, and I think that's 45.
Okay.
So 45% of our staff is at that point. But yes, those numbers are all factored into the traffic study.
Great, thank you.
There are professional medical people on staff at all times?
with assisted living? Does that
We have on staff some registered nurses. Mm-hmm. However, their primary function is to dispense prescription medications. Mm-hmm. It's not to respond to medical emergencies. Mm-hmm. In the senior living world, there's been a shift over the last few years, and a number of these facilities were always built under a medical model. Mm-hmm. We now build them under more of a hospitality model. And so if there are medical emergencies, then professionals are called in or people are taken to other locations.
And you offer all kind of services and opportunities for them to have a good quality of life there as they, with different activities.
Yeah, I'll tell you from personal experience, there may be a different definition of what continuum of care means to different, but I'll tell you what it means to us. It means the experience that my late in-laws had. And they decided that they didn't want their children saddled with making a decision about where they lived and what would happen to them. And so they themselves sold their single family home, moved into a community exactly like we're talking about here. After a certain point in time, my mother-in-law developed some physical challenges that required that she move into the assisted care area or apartments. A little bit later on, she moved into the memory care. But for the rest of her life, she and my father-in-law had every meal together, saw each other many times during the day, and lived under the same roof. That's what continuum of care is, and that's what this facility will provide.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Your site plan shows connectivity between Gateway Village and also with the parking lot of the church. Are those open roadways? Are they intended for use only in an emergency scenario, or what?
How do you describe those?
There is a platted access there intended for connectivity to Gateway Village. It's not restricted, right?
Okay.
For access,
but also to the parking lot below.
I'm not sure if there's a public access across the church's parking lot. The church is the seller of the property, and the church has agreed to the connectivity requirements of the city of Franklin. We are connecting to the parking lot of the church. Yeah.
The parking lot's not set up to be a residential street.
It's not set up to be a residential street, but it is cross connectivity, emergency vehicles, etc. Making sure that we get cross points of connection.
Emergency vehicles.
True.
We've got to be careful about turning the parking lot into interstate.
That's true. At Gateway Village, though, their intersection that's closest to this property is signalized. I think the signals are up right now. They just haven't been activated. So we know that once those are activated, that's going to be the draw to the intersection. Now, these other intersections are not signalized. The one here is not signalized. Okay. So.
This intersection is not signalized.
Where our access is out onto Franklin Road will not be a signalized access, correct?
Okay. Then I guess there's an assumption, too, that service vehicles, trash trucks, things like that, will never use access to either of the adjoining properties, that those vehicles will come through the parking areas of and drive
on the property, correct.
Other questions, comments?
Thank you very much. We appreciate it.
Appreciate it. Okay. Did an amazing job of staying on schedule.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So with that, we will call this adjourned.